2021 by Justice Ravindra Bhat on fundamental rights and the role of the regulatory state. We are here to celebrate the memory of a person who perhaps more than anyone else worked for realizing the fundamental rights of his fellow citizens, whether it was through his path-breaking work in intellectual property, including his interventions in the Novartis judgment, or through the organization he founded, IDIA, Increasing Diversity by Increasing Access to Education. Shyamna dedicated his life to applying his knowledge of the law for the improvement of humanity. His legacy lives on through the ever-popular Spicy IP blog and the impact of IDIA, which has been working on achieving substantive equality by overcoming barriers to education. To celebrate that memory, we cannot have a better speaker than Justice Bhat, who has had such an inspiring career as a lawyer and over 17 years at the bench, first as a judge in the Delhi High Court, then as Chief Justice of the Rajasthan High Court, and now as a judge of the Supreme Court of India. Justice Bhat has authored many landmark judgments that have deepened our understanding of fundamental rights, non-discrimination, gender equality, and fairness. In Madhu v. Northern Railways, he introduced the concept of indirect discrimination in our jurisprudence. In BGP products, he advanced the rights of pregnant women. In Sanjeev Kalia, he reiterated the importance of safe workplace and standard equipment, even if members of the armed forces consent to the risk. An issue that has become all too present in the work done by our frontline workers in these COVID times. The format for today will be that Mr. Santosh Mathew, Shyamnath's friend, will speak for about 5 minutes. Mr. Mathew, who has over 25 years of experience practicing in the Kerala High Court, was friends with Shyamnath since their days in law school at NLS Bangalore. After that, Justice Bhat will be giving his keynote speech, and then we will be hosting question answer sessions. Please put in your question and answers in the chat box, and we will be fielding them after Justice Bhat speaks. Over to you, Sir Santosh, sir.
Respected Justice Ravindra Bhat, thank you, Live Law, for giving me this opportunity to remember my dear friend, Mr. Shyamnath Bashir. Now, last year, during the lecture, our dear friend Rohit Mam and Alex remembered Shyamnath. This year, unfortunately, we don't have Rohit with us. He left us in May 2021. And during his speech, he compared his relationship with him and Shyamnath as that of Joey and Chandler in Friends series. Now, hopefully, Joey and Chandler will be together somewhere up above. Now, coming to Shyamnath, Justice Ravindra Bhat, during a recent speech, said that judges are the last door people knock. I firmly believe that lawyers give that voice to the people when they are knocking at the doors of justice. Shyamnath, while starting IDIA, the main intention was to empower children from underprivileged background to have access to the best of legal education possible so that they can empower people from the lower strata to be a voice of those who are downtrodden. In this regard, Shyamnath had initiated various public interest litigations throughout the country, which helped to pave way for a regular CLAT examination happening. And whenever there was any discrepancies in the CLAT entrance examination, Shyamnath was the first as a litigant to knock at the doors of justice. I have a habit of collecting pens, and I always thought that if I wrote with a good pen, my handwriting would improve. But then I realized that whatever be the pen, since it is me who is writing, it doesn't make any difference. So each one of us are given certain talents which needs to be nurtured. And Shyamnath is a person who lived life in the short span while he was here. He lived life the fullest. He was known as a brilliant academician. As Vrinda said, he was a blogger also, and he was a litigant also. In 2019, Managing IP prepared a list of 50 most influential people in the field of intellectual property. And two people from India were Shyamnath Bashir and Justice Ravindra Bhat. We Malayalis have a weakness of trying to find a Malayali connection with anybody connected with the society. Now, I want to bring in one Malayali connection here also. We have Justice Ravindra Bhat, who has a connection with the northern tip of Kerala. And when we are here to remember a son who is from the southern tip of Kerala, I think Justice Ravindra Bhat is the best person to give his lecture on the subject which is dear to him. Now, as far as Justice Bhat is concerned, he started a judgment, BJP products judgment versus Union of India, by quoting Oliver Wendell Holmes saying, "Youths fade, love droops, the leaves of friendship fails, a mother's secret hopes out, lives all." Now here, Shamnad had a vision. He had a hope that we can make a difference by empowering young people. Since a lot of people are hearing this particular lecture, my appeal is, while we are encouraging people to come and take law, they need a lot of assistance from lawyers and who are well-wishers of lawyers. So I think we should do our bit to try and help those underprivileged children while they study law. And after they graduate also, I think unless and until they get exposure to litigation, etc., they will not become lawyers who they want to be. So I think we should all try and give them an opportunity to do internship, to have jobs in the best of firms possible. I think each firm also have a social obligation to ensure that they earmark a particular quota for children from underprivileged backgrounds to have an exposure. So I think since all of us are eagerly waiting for Justice Bhat for the lecture, over to you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Sorry.
No, go ahead, Justice Bhat.
No, I think you wanted to say something. Please go ahead.
No, I just wanted to thank you, Mr. Matthew, so much. Just echoing his words, if I can ask everyone here who can and is able to contribute to IDIA, I think there is perhaps no better way to remember Shamnad. And with these words, if I can now ask Justice Bhat to deliver his address on fundamental rights and the role of the regulatory state.
Thank you. Good evening to all of you that have tuned in to the second Professor Shamnad Bashir Memorial Lecture. I extend my thanks to LiveLaw for organizing this and inviting me to speak at this event. I'm even honored, and personally, I think it's a privilege. Greetings to Mr. Santosh Matthew, Ms. Brinda Bhandari, who is to be the moderator for this session. My greetings specially to members of Shamnad Bashir's family who are part of the audience. Greetings to all of you. I knew Shamnad since 2007. His reputation as a scholar was formidable. At that time, I was a novice in intellectual property rights. Having read his articles and academic writings, it was pleasant to discover how disarmingly friendly and warm he was personally. I maintained contact with him ever since, and I last remember having seen him sometime in early 2019. All of you present know his learning and passion in the area of intellectual property rights. To me personally, his engagement and the involvement of Black litter lawyers in the field of IPR was enriching, because more than others, his objective engagements on the subject made me aware of how judges have to get off their hobby horses, lay aside their own predilections, and concentrate on their role as balancing legal requirements with the unmet needs of society. Shamnad was deeply conscious of the inherent inequalities of opportunity that persist in our society, which Mr. Matthew so poignantly spoke about. Whether it was based on caste, gender, disability, economic conditions, or geographical barriers, his commitment to social empowerment led him to founding the IDIA Trust over a decade ago. And I think his first foray was in Sikkim and Himachal Pradesh. And this was to tackle a very real issue of social representation and exclusion in legal education, having found that as a young assistant professor, most of the students whom he was teaching were from a kind of background, a certain urban, there was an urban class, middle class slant with emphasis on English speaking. It is to tackle this issue of social representation and inclusion in legal education, therefore, in which there was a big vacuum, that he created a rich legacy and he left it behind. I was fortunate to be asked to preside over the first anniversary award function, which he held in Delhi. Shamna's idea, which is a pioneering effort, has a lasting impact, not in the least because it is indelible for the beneficiaries of the programs and the legal fraternity that as a result is enriched, but also because it inspires others to take their own small measures. It was in this spirit and in keeping in mind his passion for fairness that I thought to speak on the topic fundamental rights and the role of the regulatory state. To begin with, fundamental rights guaranteed in the Constitution were traditionally applied vertically. That is, they operate as limitations on the power of the state to impose negative obligations on the side of the state, not to encroach on individual liberties, and are seen as enforceable only against the state. This view, or rather a restrictive view, held the field for a long time in the 50s and 60s, is best typified in one judgment called Sham Dasani, where the Supreme Court said that neither Article 19.1 nor Article 13.1, that is a right injunction against taking of property without authority of law, was intended to prevent wrongful individual acts or to provide protection against merely private conduct. This case is often cited to claim that the remedy is open only against state action and not to private individuals. The question that I wish to pose is, what constitutes public interest over 70 years now after the independence and after we have become a republic? How should it be interpreted in the context of the evolving relationship between the state and citizens in modern times, where post-liberalization and globalization, the state has transitioned from its erstwhile omnipresent role of provider to a retreating state and playing the role of a facilitator? Can we situate this duty upon the state to exercise its legitimate power to enact legislations and frameworks, firstly, to ensure that private entities that now have a role to play in our daily needs, relations, and lives broadly have similar limitations against impinging upon fundamental freedoms of the individual? And secondly, more fundamentally, to foster a culture of fairness, non-discrimination, and accountability that informs all our institutions and interactions. This perhaps seems lofty, and some may dismiss what I'm saying as very utopian or idealistic. But this is how I envision, as I hope all do, the larger picture of the Constitution working in a real sense, with all its minute cogs, nuts, and bolts for each individual and the spirit of fraternity at large. I don't believe that courts are to swoop in and play this role, but it is in fact incumbent upon the state to nurture this environment of fairness and promote the rule of law as a prerequisite through a wide spectrum of legislation and frameworks that regulate our daily interactions as per the core values of our Constitution. In contrast, the court's role is complementary, a safety valve as such, which must step in when there is a lapse to ensure that these rights are enforceable. Perhaps the best anecdote I will explain is a subjective one. Back when I was a lawyer, I had argued a case, M.H. Devendrappa, a union leader. I was appearing for a union leader who was a whistleblower, a term unknown at that time. In 1988, he was charge-sheeted for speaking about corruption by the management, and he was dismissed after an inquiry. It was argued that the employee had not given up his fundamental rights by being a public servant. I quoted an older Constitution Bench judgment, O.C. Ghosh versus E.X. Joseph. But the court in Devendrappa was unimpressed and upheld the dismissal. Of course, we have traveled a long way. We know who whistleblowers are. And though whistleblowers in public employment are sometimes victimized, courts do step in and use the public law remedies to cure injustices. It is that sense of innate injustice wherein I believe that the working of the Constitution was not felt by that employee that day. Today, I hope to draw some attention and thinking to unregulated spaces that individuals encounter in their lives, which require intervention in, and discuss other areas in which regulatory mechanisms, which are steeped in the values of fairness and non-discrimination, have succeeded in fostering this culture of accountability. Before I elaborate further, let me preface this speech by first situating the source of this positive obligation or duty that I'm referring to. International law has some examples of such obligations on states. The most apt is the Declaration on the Right and Responsibility of Individuals, Groups, and Organs of Society to promote and protect universally recognized human rights and fundamental freedoms. This was adopted by the UN General Assembly on 9th December 1998. Clause 1 of Article 2 of that declaration states that each state has a prime responsibility and duty to protect, promote, and implement all human rights and fundamental freedoms inter alia by adopting such steps as may be necessary to create all conditions necessary in the social, economic, political, and other fields, as well as in the legal guarantees required to ensure that all persons under its jurisdiction, individually and in association with others, are able to enjoy those rights and freedoms in practice. However, this source can be traced within the confines of domestic law itself, I believe. It's not far-fetched or whimsical understanding, but very much rooted in the text of the Constitution, and we need not look further than Article and then Part 3. Article 14, for instance, reads that the state shall not deny any person equality before the law or equal protection of the laws within the territory of India. Or that Article 15.1, which states that the state shall not discriminate against any citizen on grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, or any of them. The use of the word shall must be understood relatively or temporally. It cannot mean that with the retreating state in the provision of services directly, in its modern recharacterization, that this obligation is abdicated. Instead, it is an indirect obligation, still equally pertinent for the state to ensure that these constitutional principles and values continue to inform our institutions and interactions. There are enough available examples, and I shall be dealing with them and elaborating later, in the form of legislation. There are numerous clues within the Constitution itself that principles of fairness, equality, and accountability serve as core values informing the constitutional machinery. For instance, consider Part 9 of the Constitution, which is the inclusion of the Panchayati Raj system within the text of the Constitution. It is perhaps the best example of this. The ethos behind this part is to ensure democratic participation at grassroots level and effective representation at different tiers of governance by promoting substantive equality through reservations to include marginalized community at the decision-making levels. This is implemented through an intersectional framework of interlocking vertical and horizontal reservations. We have proportional reservation for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, within which 1/3 seats are reserved for SC/ST women, in addition to an overall 1/3 reservation of seats for women. Similarly, at the chairperson level as well, these reservations for scheduled castes and tribes and women exist and are implemented on rotational basis between different panchayats. So through this framework of interlocking vertical and horizontal reservations, the Constitution has imbibed principles of participation, fairness, equality in different levels of governance, of basic governance, I would add. What is the concept of fairness? For this, I would go back to the 1950s. In fact, one of the earliest judgments, a dissenting judgment of Justice Bose, in his stirring minority opinion in the Anwar Ali Sarkar, said that freedom was won at a great price and that history should not be forgotten in placing limits on a dynamic concept such as equality. He called for a case-by-case examination with a broad sense of what equality stands for. I call upon his rousing but clear exposition of the concept of equality to help make my point. He talked very passionately about the brooding spirit of the law and the awareness of the felt injustices of the past, and that the words of equality before law are not just dull, lifeless words, static and hidebound in some mummified manuscript, but living flames intended to give life to a great nation and order its beings, tongues of dynamic flame, potent to mold the future as well as guide the present. He underlined that the Constitution must, in my judgment, be left elastic enough to meet from time to time the altering conditions, mark that, altering conditions of a changing world with its shifting emphasis on differing needs. I feel, therefore, that in each case, judges must look straight into the heart of things and regard the facts of each case concretely, must as a jury would do, and yet not quite as a jury, for we are considering here a matter of law and not just one of fact. Do these laws which have been called into question offend a still greater law before which even they must bow? Early interpretations of the fundamental rights and concepts of liberties of individuals situated these in individual silos, that is the A.K. Gopalan. These underwent a dramatic change in the 1970s through two very important judgments, the 11 judgments, the 11 bench ruling in bank nationalization and later in Manika Gandhi, where the court held that the correct perspective is not to see what the law or policy intends, but rather the impact of it on one or more fundamental rights. That the fundamental rights were interconnected. In fact, I think in one of the judgments, they say that the liberties are all interlinked and the seven freedoms are seven lamps. This expanded meaning of the equality clause, its link with other provisions, and the new meaning of liberty has resulted in a dramatic change in the content of these rights, which must continue to develop in the changing circumstances of our times. We have instances wherein this evolving scope of fundamental rights has been recognized both by the state and the court. Now, if keeping that in mind, I'll now move to what is the concept of non-discrimination or its horizontal application, as legal scholars are very fond of putting it. Articles 15, 2, 17, 23 and 24 provide for wide scope of protection against discrimination, social abuses like untouchability, forced labor, exploitation of children in a horizontal manner. In other words, they are not directed exclusively against the state. Article 15 enjoins that no citizen shall, on grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, or any of them, be subject to any disability, liability, restriction, or condition. Firstly, with respect to access to shops, public restaurants, hotels, and places of public entertainment. And secondly, the use of wells, tanks, bathing ghats, roads, and places of public resort maintained wholly or partly out of state funds or dedicated to the use of the general public. It is assumed that in the framing of Clause 2, much like Clause 3 and 4 of 15, it reflects that it is executory and not a self-executing provision, that it does not give rise to enforceable legal rights in favor of any individual, as long as the state does not make a law, say, penalizing the practice of discrimination at places of public resort in Clause 2. Such a reading would be quite similar to that of the U.S. Supreme Court in the older civil rights cases, which in fact was cited with approval in Shiv Shyam Dasani, ironically, which I referred to. However, there has been a change in tide since then. The court has in recent times interpreted Article 17 and Article 15 too and rendered it more enforceable in nature. The first example which comes for in respect of Article 17, apart from its obvious enforcement through the laws enacted by Parliament, that is the Civil Rights Act and the SCST Prevention of Atrocities Act, is the case of the Sabarimala temple entry judgment, where the court, while looking into the practice of prohibition of temple entry for women as discrimination on Article 15, also emphasized on the practice being prohibited under Article 17 as a restriction of entry of women aged 50 to 10 to 50 in any form, and exclusion of women from religious places and practices because they menstruate and are considered impure during that time, that it was no less a form of discrimination. I'm conscious that this was not the majority reasoning, but this is one seed which has been sown, which may be taken up in later cases. Earlier, we had Anuj Garg, where the state act prohibited employment of women in any part of such premises in where liquor or intoxicating drugs were consumed. And the state was not dealing with its premises, but private premises. The court said that such a restriction was violative of Article 15. As there is a difference created between employment based on sex of the individual. And the court also characterized this protection as a romanticized one while striking it down. Even earlier in PODR versus Union of India, the court observed that there are certain fundamental rights conferred by the Constitution which are enforceable against the whole world, and they are to be found in Articles 17, 24, and 34, and 23 and 24. I'm also reminded of a very beautiful and small judgment beautifully written by Justice Bhagwati, Sanjit Roy versus Union of India, where, of course, the context was a state law which overrode the Minimum Wages Act and enabled the state of Rajasthan to pay towards relief work as a measure of famine relief, amounts which were lower than minimum wages. The court said that this amounts to forced labor, and that the choice of not accepting is no choice. It's a Hobson's choice, and that therefore this amounts to exploitation. So I would also commend those of you who are lawyers to go through that judgment. It's a beautifully conceived judgment in 1983. Recently, in Consumer Education and Research Center versus Union of India, the court held that the right of workers to health lies against private employers, as well as that these private actors are bound by directions under Article 32. It said, importantly, that the state, be it union or state government or an industry, private or public, is enjoined to take all such action which will promote health, strength, and vigor of workmen during the period of employment, and leisure and health, even after retirement, as basic essentials to lead the life with health and happiness. Since violation of Articles 17 and 23(1) are offenses punishable by law, remedies would be statutory, that is prosecution and not constitutional. The Protection of Civil Rights Act made violation of Article 15(2) punishable only if exclusion from such public places by a private individual is committed on the ground of untouchability. Taking notice of the practice prevalent in tea stalls in hotels in Tamil Nadu, where a two-tumbler system was followed, separate tumblers for serving tea or other drink to SC persons and non-scheduled caste persons, the court held that such practice was not only highly objectionable, but violative of Articles 15, 2, and 17 of the Constitution, and an offense under the Act. Directions were issued to administrative and police officials to take steps to prevent that practice. But then I put the question, what would be the case if a citizen is excluded on the ground of his or her race, caste, or gender from using a park or tank dedicated to the public by another private person? In my opinion, the absence of sanction under Article 15.2 does not render this immaterial. Article 15.2a ensures equal access to shops, restaurants, hotels, places of private entertainment owned by private persons as well. That is, state aid is not a prerequisite for enforcing this right, as in the case of subclause B. It is true that the explicit word relate to access to shops, but a plain reading of the Constituent Assembly debate surrounding the drafting of this article confirms that it provides protection from discrimination perpetrated by anyone providing a service. Dr. Ambedkar stated in his speech that to define the word shop in its most generic term one can think of is to state that shop is a place where the owner is prepared to offer his service to anybody who is prepared to go there seeking his service. Certainly it will include anybody who offers his services. I'm using it in a generic sense. I would like to point out, therefore, that the word shop used here is not used in the limited sense of permitting entry. It is used in the larger sense of requiring the services if the terms of service are agreed to. This speech was cited and relied on in the Indian Medical Association case, where the issue of Indian Military Academy case, where the issue of Army College of Medical Sciences having the policy of providing admissions only to children of Army personnel, the Supreme Court interpreted schools, that is private, non-minority aided professional, unaided professional educations to fall within the ambit of shops for the purpose of protection against private discrimination. Therefore, Article 15.2 perhaps provides the foundation for a general prohibition of discriminatory behavior and is not confined to the state alone. This has been one interpretation of the protection of under Article 15. On the other hand, the Supreme Court has taken a different position while dealing with discrimination based on religion as opposed to the right to and the right to association. In the Zoroastrian case in 2005, where bylaws of the society permitted the sale of the house by one Parsi member to only another Parsi, the Supreme Court, while reversing the decision of the High Court, held that such restriction was permitted. The court said that the bylaws of a cooperative society setting out the terms of membership to it is a contract entered into by a person when he seeks to become a member of the society, and such being a private contract between two individuals, Part 3 will not be attracted. By holding this, the court in a sense held that bylaws of exclusion should be allowed to stand. Further, the court also limited the scope for public policy to fill in the lacunae by holding that public policy should be seen within the ambit of the concerned enactment. There can be a different way of looking at it, in my opinion. The right to contract and economic freedoms are important rights enjoyed by citizens. Equally, the right to equality and non-discrimination are fundamental in nature. Considering that these rights are in themselves constitutionally protected as inalienable, economic freedoms and other such freedoms must be balanced in such a manner that all vulnerable groups too can effectively enjoy the right to equality and non-discrimination. Therefore, when two freedoms are seemingly in conflict, there is a need to balance the public interest in enforcing one right over the other. A concept not unknown, because many recent judgments have spoken about it. And this need to balance is also to be considered in the context of the prospect of harm in the form of exclusion solely based on protected attributes of upholding one rights over the other. So this, I think there is a need for, let's say, revisiting these concepts in a light of later understanding about the pervasiveness of the rights. My point is put poignantly in the opinion long ago expressed by the US Supreme Court in an illuminating judgment called Mann versus Illinois, which was a case I think many scholars and students of law are aware, where in one passage Justice Waite said, looking then to the common law, from whence came the right which the Constitution protects, we find that when private property is affected with the public interest, it ceases to be juris private only. In other words, when private property, and by extension, the private sphere, is affected with the public interest, that is discriminatory practice or action, there is a strong case to be made for the state to step in and frame laws and create regulatory frameworks to protect interests of the individuals. Now I move on to the state's role as a facilitator. It is of no doubt that time and again we have seen the state making positive intervention to make policies that further fundamental rights. The first of these is as a facilitator, where the state has accepted court directions and guidelines and embodied them in the shape of legislation. The most celebrated example is Vishakha, where the Supreme Court noted the lacuna in the law with respect to sexual harassment in the workplace and laid down elaborate guidelines and norms based upon the CEDAW framework for the protection of women in workplaces and other institutions in exercise of its power under Article 32 to enforce the rights under Articles 14, 15, 19, 21, and so on. Pursuant to this judgment, the Parliament enacted the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Prohibition, and Redressal Act 2013 to provide protection against sexual harassment of women at the workplace and prevention and redressal of complaints of sexual harassment, which leads to the regulatory role of the state in protecting the fundamental rights of women under Articles 14 and 15 of the Constitution and their dignity under Article 12 of the Constitution. What is to be noted here is that it was the state that was the respondent. The court imposed the obligation upon it to protect the fundamental rights, which it finally did by enacting a law. The important part here is that this law applies not merely to establishments under the control of the union or the states, but horizontally to all private individuals and important workplaces. And it has a very strong underlying public policy underpinning, which is that an act of sexual harassment is not confined should not be seen as a mere misconduct of an employee vis-a-vis his employer, but it threatens the security and safety of female employees, and if the employer fails to take action, in this regard, the result is that the female employees are at an insecure place. The employer would be in a position of distrust. Another area where the state has played a complementary as well as supplementary role, that is as a regulator and facilitator, is in the field of education. This sector is highly regulated both at the central and state government level and consists of diverse central laws, national policies, and legislation. From the year 1950 to 1976, education was essentially a state subject under the Constitution, with the role of the central government being limited to running the central universities, institutions of training and research, and coordinating standards. However, the 42nd Amendment in 1976 shifted education in general from the state list to the concurrent list, that thus giving both central and state governments jurisdiction over it concurrently. The first judgment of note, or rather the beginning of this journey here, is Mohini Jain, 1991, where the Supreme Court extended the obligation to charge a reasonable fee and imposed a duty upon managements of not only government but private educational institutions, including colleges of professional institutions of learning and private universities. This led to a call for review of the law declared in that judgment. As a result, the Supreme Court's initial formulation in Unnikrishnan drew up a firm law whereby in private educational institutions, 50% of the seats were to be earmarked as merit quota to be filled by a common entrance test conducted by state agencies, and the others earmarked as management quota for which seats were to be for which the fees were to be prescribed by the government, and against students were to be admitted on merit. The quota requirements were questioned, and again in TMA Pai Foundation, in a larger bench ruling of 11 judges, the Supreme Court reviewed the entire law and held that both minority and non-minority educational institutions were not constrained by any quota. At the same time, the court also permitted states to regulate admission and fee. Importantly, the court said that commercialization is not permitted, although private institutions do carry on their profession or vocation while they establish educational institutions. The subsequent judgment in Sankalp is Education Trust is very important because it stated that a common admission test should be organized based on which admissions are to be given in all instances at the national and state levels for courses of higher professional education, such as medicine, engineering, architecture, etc. This is a very significant step. The judgment has been assimilated in the form of binding rules framed by the concerned professional regulatory bodies, which are empowered to grant recognition and affiliation to these educational institutions. The journey of fairness, so to speak, that began with Mohini Jain has culminated in dissemination over a wider spectrum of its acceptance to legislation, leaving private entities with little scope or arbitrary conduct, at least in regard to admission. In the field of primary education too, the seeds of obligation in the form of universal primary education were sown in Mohini Jain and endorsed in Unnikrishnan. This finally led to the enactment of the 86th Constitutional Amendment, which has universalized education and introduced Article 21A, which ensures access to primary education till the age of 14. That does not mean to be merely a promise. That it does not mean to be a promise was affirmed through the enactment of the Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Act, which is known as the RTE, which made it obligatory for private schools to set up 25% quota for children of economically weaker sections of society. Finally, the validity of Article 28 and RTE Act was upheld by 5 judges in Pramati. The only caveat which the court added was that the RTE would not be applied to schools established and managed by minorities. The Supreme Court was of the opinion that granting a small percentage of seats in private education, educational institutions for weaker sections, the administrative, the propriety in keeping with Article 16, does not impinge upon the right under Article 19(1)(g) of the Constitution. The next example would be the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016. It facilitates measures that are necessary for the realization of the rights of persons with disabilities and ensure their full citizenship rights and enjoyment of their fundamental freedoms under Articles 14, 19, 15 and 21. This law provides comprehensive safeguards and mandates a reasonable accommodation, ensuring equality in all aspects of society to persons with disabilities. This is the second instance where the state has shown commitment to obligations under the directive principles and enacted legislation, which directly or indirectly gives effect to each fundamental right. Likewise, as I referred to earlier, the Equal Remuneration Act of 1976 assures that women are paid the same wages for the same kind of work as men are paid. Other laws which have sought to apply these values horizontally include the Senior Citizens Maintenance Act, which can be enforced against private citizens, certain provisions of the Companies Act 2013, which mandate appointment of women as directors, among others, and a large swathe of labor legislation, particularly the one concerning safety of workmen, hours of work, minimum wages, maternity benefits, and so on. Now coming to the unregulated and in some ways the unlegislated field, which is going to be the next probably most important area of the topic that I've chosen, is the first I will deal with privacy. The need for personal data protection and privacy issues fairly flows from the enlarged scope of the ambit under Article 21 of the Constitution. As now the right to privacy has been recognized as a fundamental one in the Puttuswamy judgment. Mostly non-state actors, that is private entities, which provide services that have the potential to encroach upon an individual's right to privacy, without there being any effective mechanism in the form of positive law to enforce their right against these entities, or for that matter, even the state, is a very important lacunae. As informational privacy is low on the priority in legislative order of business, the government's reliance on technology as its peak and data-driven governance is becoming increasingly ubiquitous every day. In this regard, many developed as well as developing nations have framed regulations concerning regarding personal data protection, such as the General Data Protection Regulation formed by the European Union, which addresses a large, almost all known areas of transfer of personal data, regulation of data, transfer outside the EU, and the EEA, the European Economic Area. The enforcement of these regulations, known as the GDPR, created a seismic global shift in how countries, organizations, and individuals view data privacy, and saw a rapid global move toward more rigorous control and protection. And these regulations have become a model for many countries, including UK, Turkey, Mauritius, Chile, Japan, Brazil, South Korea, Argentina, Kenya, etc. Regrettably, we are still left standing, although the articulation of this right to privacy took place in 2017. The absence of legislation makes this right somewhat academic. And in the absence of a clearly enunciated data law, which sets out regulations as well as rights and the remedies, the nature of that right is rendered by and large a dead letter, except in extremely rare cases where one can approach a writ court and seek enforcement against the state. With the rapid expansion and increasing complexity of economic activity in India since the 90s, it was felt that traditional instrumentalities of the state could not resolve issues that were of a technical nature by employing the usual way. The need for experts was keenly felt that were attuned to the often rapid developments in a given sector and could identify and act on challenges posed in a manner that did not result in the concentration of wealth and means of production to the common detriment, which is the which is the tenet under Clause 39C of the Constitution. Thus came certain sectoral regulators in India, which today have proliferated, ranging from banking to insurance, competition, telecom, electricity, and so on. A look at the objectives of these legislation giving rise to regulators displays a uniform twin requirement of protecting the interests of the public, the ultimate stakeholders in the economy, and promoting development of the given sector. As diverse as these sectors may be, and as different the technical expertise required to resolve issues unique to them, the role of all regulators is to ensure that entities operating in the sector do so in a manner which is fair and non-discriminatory, so as to not prejudice the interest of the public. This requirement was laid down time and again by the courts in the pre-economic liberalization era, where the state constituted monopolies in virtually all sectors dispensing critical services, and state instrumentalities also govern those sectors. In Shetty, R.D. Shetty, the Supreme Court recognized that the principle of reasonableness and rationality, which is legally as well as philosophically an essential element of equality or non-arbitrariness, is projected by Article 14, and it must characterize every state action. Post-liberalization, many of the services offered by the state hitherto were taken over by private entities, consequently also increasing their foothold in the concerned sectors. The state experienced a gradual shift in its role from being a provider to now becoming a regulator. While there was no doubt that statutory obligations applied to both public and private entities, which also contained penalties for their violations, the questions which arise: what about breaches beyond the black letter of the statute? Could violation of fundamental rights be invoked against private players? And what is the regulator's role? There have been a few instances in Arun Kumar versus Arun Kumar Agarwal. Supreme Court, while discussing the role of the SEBI, or the Securities Exchange of India, Board of India, held that the appointment of chairman was in violation of an express provision of the statute, which provided that the chairman to be a person of high integrity, vested a right in a public interest litigant to challenge it under the writ jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. This was because malfunctioning in the performance of the function of chairman would adversely impact the economy. Similarly, SEBI has framed regulations prohibiting insider trading as unaddressed, it would result in unfairness in the marketplace. Most regulatory laws, that is those concerning energy, electricity, competition, telecom, etc., have embedded principles of reasonableness, fairness, and non-discrimination in the dealings of private entities between each other, and to avoid abuse of dominance. This culture of fairness must be brought into other private spaces as well. In March 2021, this year, when a mobile application widely used by the public proposed to amend its privacy policy in terms of service unilaterally, making acceptance of its services, fresh services and terms mandatory, the Competition Commission initiated a suo motu investigation. Although the reason for investigation is undoubtedly rooted in the provisions of the Competition Act, which permits the Commission to intervene in respect of acts which, according to it, contravene sections 3, 4, or 6, it is clear that such an act also upholds the fundamental right to privacy of data of users, who may be unaware of the manner in which their data and private information may be shared. Access to fundamental rights cannot be deprived to people on the basis of their economic status. For example, there is a crippling lacuna in the law when it comes to workers' rights in the unorganized sector, which as of 2015, comprised of nearly 93% of the workforce, translating to roughly 45 crore people. In a report published by the Union Ministry of Labour and Employment, it was stated that not less than 23% of workers in the informal sector had paid leave or access to, that less than 23% had access to paid leave or social security benefits. Private entities often hire workers on contractual basis in order to keep costs low, which includes imposition of unreasonable and very onerous conditions such as dismissal at will. This is now found in even rapidly expanding companies which generate billions of dollars in profits annually, but deny with awarding basic requirements to their workers on the defense that they are not state and cannot be burdened with the onerous responsibility of upholding their workers' fundamental rights. It is in this gray area, it becomes all the more crucial for sectoral regulators to intervene, without which constitutional values and fundamental rights will cease to have any meaning, at least till legislative lacuna is addressed. And the last section which I will wish to deal with is the unregulated area. That is not just those which are regulated by regulators, but the other private spaces. The involvement of burgeoning private sector on the one hand, and the shrinking of the state in key areas of the economy, such as in physical infrastructure, energy, mining, telecom, internet, and e-commerce services, has made the role of each of these entities as omniscient as that of the state in the pre-liberalized era. Apart from the obvious need of framing new policies to address workers' and employees' concerns, such as regulation of their working hours, defining new relationships between those with asymmetrical power and bargaining power, one needs to examine closely the areas where these private entities may be framing their policies, which deal or directly, indirectly affect the exercise of legitimate fundamental rights. The most striking example would be discriminatory recruitment policy. Article 15.1 enacts other prohibited grounds on which discrimination is not possible. Yet, since private employers are not covered by that provision, it is possible for them to blatantly discriminate people on the basis of gender, caste, religion, language, or any other ground, including age. At times, employment is denied for no ostensible reason. There are other reasons which are very evident to persons discriminated against, such as bias in favor of family, personal views, discrimination based on age, disability even, etc. These forms of discrimination at the time of employment are hard to prove. There is no mechanism to prove that the employers adhere to non-discriminatory practices. Likewise, fairness in the workplace during the employment, or rather breach of it, is hard to prove and harder to get remedy for. Industrial workmen who can legitimately complain of arbitrary dismissal are subjected often to the prospect of fighting managements with deep pockets and have to ensue extreme hardship for years, which may result in small victories. However, large swathes of employees not covered by the organized sector, who are part of the contractual workforce, either in the largest form, that is as unskilled workers, or those rendering skilled work, such as computer professionals who are in employment, are not beneficiaries of any fairness norms. They're being kept out of the field of industrial disputes or for any other mechanism which gives a just and impartial hearing to their grievance only accentuates the unfairness of their situation. It is here that there is need for a different approach, where the state is an active facilitator and enacts a broad law, a uniform obligation embodying principles of equity and equality that have to apply everywhere. This idea, in a sense, stems out of the Constituent Assembly debates centering on what is meant by access under Article 15.2. there are inherent limitations when access has to be meant to be directed for a particular type of service beneficiary. However, the court has shown in the IMA case that access was interpreted to mean admission, a wider concept. Based on this interpretation, it is high time that the state considers enacting a law of universal application to enforce principles of equity, equality, and non-discrimination. We would not be the first if we do enact such a law. The first of these was brought into force by the South African legislature, which enacted the Promotion of Equality and Preservation of Unfair Discrimination Act, which is known as the Equality Act, in 2000. Its provisions constitute every high court as an equality court to enforce its the rights under the act. Discrimination is defined as any act or including a policy, condition, or situation which directly or indirectly imposes burdens, obligations, or disadvantages, or withholds benefits towards advantages from any person or more prohibited groups. Prohibited groups are unfair discriminations directly or indirectly based on gender, sex, pregnancy, marital or social region, marital status or social region, color, sexual orientation, age, disability, relationships, and belief. This prohibition applies equally to all, that is the state as well as private entities and persons. Likewise, in the UK Equality Act recognizes and provides remedies for discrimination based on all forms, direct or indirect, of discrimination based on age, disability, gender reassignment, marriage or civil partnership, pregnancy or maternity, race, religion or belief, sex or sexual orientation. The US Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 prohibits discrimination in the workplace based on race, color, religion, sex, and nationalism. There is a wealth of jurisprudence in the form of what is permissible and what amounts to discrimination in each of these countries. The state's facilitative role in fostering a culture of respect for fundamental rights is as important and as overarching as its duty imposed upon the Constitution to respect it. It is enjoined not only to actively not take measures that affect fundamental rights. In the absence of state's facilitative role, a large section of the population who might be in the workforce in private employment or in private spaces can face discriminatory practices and injustices. And the majority of them would have to suffer and continue to suffer them based upon their caste, origin, poverty, or even things as innocuous as lack of English, religion, language, etc. The Constitution assures all citizens various personal liberties, and the preamble assures social justice as well as equality and fraternity. The area where the state therefore has to center and frame policies proactively is as the enforcer of fundamental rights. It is not merely in respecting in its activities, but in also ensuring that others who are not bound by fundamental rights do so through law. The failure to act on this duty would mean that there will be thousands of unaddressed injustices and a brooding sense of unfairness felt by large sections of society. The due enjoyment of any of the freedoms guaranteed under Article 19 assumes that the conditions conducive to its enjoyment are assured by the state in the form of orderliness, the form of the promise of free speech or free association would be of little use if a segment of the population holds out threats to the free enjoyment of rights by others. These rights would then be only academic. What is essentially important, therefore, is that the state acts actively in the promotion of fundamental rights, in upholding freedom of thought, expression of legitimate speech, which can be contrary to the dominant discourse freely expressed without fear of reprisal by private entities or collectives. I would conclude by saying that the idea of fairness, dignity and equality and one's worth is inalienable to every human being. The Constitution makers had this in mind while assuring all of us social justice, liberties, equality and fraternity. The concept of fraternity ties up the other liberties and enjoins all citizens to treat each other with dignity and foster respect. The role of the state in a liberalized economy to foster and engender a culture of respect to enforce fundamental freedom through legislation is the need of the hour. There is no doubt that nurturing good governance is essential to ensuring respect for fundamental freedoms and human rights. Without the rule of law, independent courts and other institutions of modern society, essential components of good governance, the promise of these freedoms may just remain that, a promise unfulfilled. Enforcement of these freedoms, when it matters, can then be rendered impossible. The lessons of history are that transparent, responsible, and participatory governance ensures fairness and justice through effective remedies, which is a prerequisite to enduring respect for human dignity and the defense of fundamental human rights. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Justice Bhatt. This was a very illuminating lecture. Thank you so much for an engaging and informative lecture. I'm sure many of us were taking detailed notes of all the cases that you were mentioning and the arc of law that you described. I certainly did. Your reference to Sabarimala, Vishakha guidelines, the RTE framework, the role of regulators, workers' rights, discriminatory recruitment policies, I think was very important. And as somebody also who works on privacy, digital rights, and public law issues, for me personally, it was very heartening to hear your views on these issues, the need for a data protection bill and equality law in India. So thank you so much. If I can request all the audience members to please post in your questions on the chat box so that I can ask Justice Bhatt. Maybe to start off with, in fact, Mr. Matthew, I think it's best to start with a question that he wanted to ask you. So Mr. Matthew's question is, Justice Bhatt, what is your opinion about the provisions of marital rape, which is the exception in rape law, which takes away a woman's autonomy over her body or choice in light of the Puttaswamy judgment? So obviously the exception that he's talking about is exception 2 of section 375, which states that sexual intercourse or act by a man of his own wife, not being under the age of 18, is not a rape. So that was Santosh Matthew's question for you.
Holding the position that I do, I don't think I can express my personal opinion to say that we had a very interesting public interest litigation going in the High Court, and which I heard for a while, but then the roster changed, and I really don't know what finally transpired. But it was a very interesting one, because the obvious sense of injustice. And there's one more aspect to that I think the punishment of offenders, even in that cases, varies if depending upon the age of the victim. So I'm aware of what Mr. Matthews has to wants a discussion on, but I refrain from giving my views on it.
I totally understand. Another thing, till we are also getting again questions. One of the questions I wanted to ask you also, you talked a lot about the employment conditions and the importance of labor rights, especially in the hiring recruitment process, as well as some of the cases you've cited on minimum wages. Do you have a view whether we need regulatory frameworks, or would the court be the position, the last bastion, if we talk about the labor rights of gig workers? So there's been a lot of controversy in recent times when you look at delivery workers and drivers and gig workers. And do you think that we need a regulatory response to that? Would that also be a kind of the state proactively facilitating rights?
Again, I'll be skating, nice here, because the best of my knowledge, some PIL has been filed, I think, in the Supreme Court recently.
Okay. So, yes.
And yet, I can say this, that it's one area which needs to be looked into, perhaps quite urgently. Beyond that, I wouldn't like to say anything. Because
it's
a matter for the court to do or for the state to look into and what kind of policies are to be framed, matter for debate.
That's perfectly fine. And you also spoke about, you know, when you looked at Sabarimala and Anuj Garg and how discrimination law has played a role in the court's reasoning. Where do you think the next areas in terms of expanding, you know, discrimination law, non-discrimination law can go forward? Like, where do you think we can, the areas that are sort of ripe for our ideas of indirect discrimination, which you yourself have championed, would be the right next steps where we can apply these principles?
The issue with this application of these principles is that it doesn't happen uniformly. If you look at indirect discrimination, the concept of indirect discrimination, I remember having written a couple of judgments. I think there's one judgment. Some of these judgments have been cited in either Shaira Banu or in Sabarimala by Justice Chandrachud. So the seeds have been sown, and yet we have a strong previous history of how discrimination is and equality have been seen in a rather strict manner, starting with Nargesh Mirza and so on and so forth. But then I always post this question, that supposing one of the proscribed grounds was scheduled caste, that excluded category candidate were a scheduled caste, would only then come in the way. The expression only has been a stumbling block. Now, can only then be such a force multiplier that it would knock off the obvious aspect of discrimination of the excluded person. So I think one has not really explored all these areas. So as I said, development of these principles, most of these would depend on a case-by-case and rather episodic manner. So there's no, one can't say how long it will take and how for a wider acceptance.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Talking purely of indirect discrimination.
Indirect discrimination in general, I think a lot of your views even on the need for equality law and the understanding has been very instructive. But I think I've asked you enough questions of my own. So Mr. Prashant Padmanabhan has a question. Sir, suppose there is an unsubstantiated statement by someone following a particular religion that certain crimes are committed upon them by followers of another religion. What should be the response of the state and the citizens? So I can repeat the question if you want. Suppose there is an unsubstantiated statement by someone following a particular religion that certain crimes are committed upon them by followers of another religion. What should be the response of the state or the citizen?
I think we have enough enacted law on this in the form of proscribed speech, which can be an offense, depending on the nature of that statement and how it has got, what kind of propensity it has to provoke or disturb the public order. If it's it all depends on the degree, as they say. So we have all those offenses, section 153 and so on and so forth.
Yes. Anirvan Sen is asking, do you think it's high time something like the US Civil Rights Act, civil action for deprivation of rights, gets incorporated either legislatively or judicially in India?
Certainly, I feel that it should be done legislatively, not judicially. The court is not cannot be the source of this kind of law. Otherwise, we would have had it long back. Therefore, it is not in the realm of the courts, within the realm of the courts to enact law. So, that's the reason, you know, sometimes courts nudge the legislature, like I said, in the case of Mohini Jain or Vishakha is the most striking example. But it was easy because in Vishakha, it was an area that was so obvious and glaring. Therefore, and I think Justice Verma's judgment said at the end that these guidelines would apply to all state establishments and state agencies till a law is enacted. And the law, of course, Parliament accepted that and enacted a wider law which applies across the board to private entities as well.
Yes, even PUCL, where they laid down the guidelines, which eventually became part of Rule 419A of the Telegraph Rules in the Surveillance Challenge. Sir. Then, sir, Advocate Ashok Sharma is asking that in district courts, if they want to engage with local problems in a PIL-style format, what is the best way to do that, to raise it on a collective basis, to raise issues that concern a particular locality or a district? What is the best way to ensure fundamental rights implementation before a district court?
The culture of human rights, so to say, we have many states have these state human rights commissions. So that is one way of looking at it, where these human rights commissions can be requested to look into the grievances. The other could be that if this is something which falls within injunctive relief, and somebody has to be creative about it and see what kind of obligations can be situated within the existing and enacted civil law. If, for instance, let's say, what is an offense? That which is contrary to Civil Rights Act or SCST prevention. A civil action on that basis, that somebody is being excluded, apart from it's being an offense, it would obviously be contrary to law. So it is moot whether you can get an injunction or some kind of a decree on that. So possibly in that kind of area, there's need to be some kind of thinking. But then there are a lot of perils in that, because once you file a suit, it gets, you follow the provisions of the Civil Procedure Code, issues are struck, trial takes place, so on and so forth. But these are areas which have not been developed in India.
Yes, 100%.
Like I keep saying that we have torts, but then the law of damages has not been developed in India. Therefore, yes, there are many unaddressed areas, and lawyers have been very creative in public interest, but in approaching writ courts, but perhaps the sheer time which is taken has blunted the growth of these branches.
Yes. Yeah, damages and compensation, I think, is really a area where we can hopefully see some jurisprudential development over the years. We have another question from Sneha Rao. Is it time we seek that right to health under Article 21? In its positive conception, imposes an obligation upon the state to provide certain minimum level of care, and not merely as a negative obligation, not to deny emergency care as it is currently perceived. Is this an area for the courts to step in, or would a comprehensive legislation be a better way to deal with it? I think the question is very relevant, especially in COVID times, where we've seen right to health having multiple facets.
Yes, in terms of international obligations, these are positive rights which the state has to ensure for its citizens. A certain element of public health, even trade law, recognizes in the form of exclusions and permissible exceptions. For instance, TRIPS Article 8 and Article 25, I think. I don't exactly remember the precise articles. So, which means that the states are under a duty to frame policies and also enact laws which confer enforceable rights. The question is, how would the court ensure that the state legislates? That's where the courts have their own limitations, and the courts can't fashion policies, because financial impact is one thing that one is unaware of, and the courts don't have the technical wherewithal for all that.
Yes.
It's one thing to articulate a right, but the actual enforcement of it through a law is quite another. After all, let's not forget, even Vishakha took about 16 years. The judgment was in 1997. The law got enacted in 2016. So for 16 years, there was a space that is the private employer space, which was unregulated as far as sexual harassment at workplace was concerned, despite Vishakha. So which means that the state becomes very becomes central in framing of these policies and enactment of these laws.
Yes. In fact, on the role of the state in enacting policies, our next question is by Aseem Chawla on the and kind of asking for a comment on the recent trend of legislative drafting processes, especially in fiscal and economic laws, has an overdose of regulations in the context of delegated legislation, such that the essence of the statute per se dilutes the tipping scale in favor of the states impacting economic freedoms, which then affects fundamental rights. So is there any way around that, especially when we look at fiscal and economic laws, especially? Or should the regulator have more powers, and is that the right?
No, I don't know, because this is a very diffused kind of query. I would only answer this fiscal and financial, perhaps even other parts. Delegated legislation has to be always kept within the bounds of what is permissible. Definitely, one has seen that delegated legislation often oversteps those bounds. Until it is there declared ultra vires, the subject suffers it. In other words, citizens continue to be bound by it. Therefore, perhaps it's time for the courts to do a rethink on tightening the oversight on these delegated legislation through a new kind of doctrine on this. Often we have most of these laws have a provision which directs the laying of these rules and regulations before parliament's table for a certain number of days, etc. The courts have taken a particular point of view, but one has to probably look into all that.
Yes, you're absolutely right. That view has come many times when we've been trying to argue something and hence have lost. We then have Madan Kure asking, what according to you should be the main essentials that should be contained in a personal data protection law that can help ensure privacy against state machinery per se? So if there is anything you think that is very important or that should be there in a data protection law or a privacy law that the state frames to ensure privacy concerns against the state specifically.
I think it's very important here to have a very independent regulator, which inspires confidence and over which the state does not have any form of control. So if there is a regulator that is in charge of all forms, of different forms, maybe more than one, maybe two or three regulators for different forms of data, possibly that will inspire greater confidence among the people and also ensure that there is participation in the framing of these regulations, which will ultimately benefit all the concerned parties. Today, everything that we do is preserved in data, knowingly, unknowingly. All of us are the subject of some kind of profiling which happens at the marketplace. And this data probably is traded a million times over. Therefore, how that is to be done, who is to store this, who is to keep an eye on this, so to say, I think it's best done by a very independent, a completely independent regulator who can inspire general public confidence. That is the best guarantee. And secondly, swift remedies for breach, preferably also in the form of some kind of compensation.
I could not agree with you more on your answer about the importance of independence of regulators and apprehension of bias. I'll just take two more questions. So we have Unnati Kumari, who's asked if you could please throw some light on any career opportunities after doing an LLM in IPR and information technology law with respect to lower judiciaries. Another sort of unrelated question by her, but under Section 6A of the Hindu Maintenance and Guardianship Act, the meaning of the words used is father, and after him, the mother is the natural guardian. And does that not violate Article 14 and 15 in the way that you had expressed an understanding?
As to the latter question, I don't know whether this point is addressed by Gita Hariharan, the judgment in Gita Hariharan, where I think the Supreme Court long back, more than 20 years ago, perhaps, took this view. I may be wrong if it's the same provision. But as to her other question on the more personal to her, as a career in the lower judiciary, if you are so minded, can be very good, but equally stressful depending on what level you join. And as far as civil, as far as giving opportunities to those qualified in IPR and have completed post-graduation, I don't know where you wish to be a judge, but now we have commercial courts all over the country. So depending on where you would like to be a judge or try to get in to become a judge as a civil judge, you may or may not get many IPR cases. It could be different in Delhi or Mumbai or some of the other larger cities. But in smaller places, perhaps not, except certain kinds of trademark action or maybe copyright action even concerning music, etc. But otherwise, you can, if you do become a judge in the commercial division, there are other opportunities where one can excel and enjoy the life of a judge.
On that great note, so that you can enjoy the remaining part of the Saturday since it's 6:30 as well. Thank you so much for taking out your time. We are truly appreciative of it. I know how difficult and how busy you are. So I'm truly grateful that you were able to share your wisdom with us and, you know, give us such an informative lecture. So thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity, all of you.